Hello, I'm really, really happy and honored to be here with you at this important event as part of the Sisters Empowering Women session on economy and health. I would like to say a few things, starting from two basic initial points. First of all, who are we as sisters? We are people who've been chosen by God to be sent. We are apostolic sisters. In that sense, we're trying to live the life of the apostles. We're sent out into the world to preach the good news, to bring the message of salvation, of hope, of freedom to humanity. So anything that we do for empowering women is part of that mission, or it should be. So I want to talk about empowering women as part of that basic gospel mission that we have. That's the first thing. And then the second thing is to make a reference to one of the phrases of our Lord in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, where he says, "All good scribes take out of their store things old and new." So I'd like to say these things in relation to what the sisters have been doing up to now, the old things, the good things, the things of the past and going on in our day, and what could be the new things that we need to think about doing, the connection between the two, the old and the new, valuing the old and looking forward to the new. So, with that said, let's talk about, I think, four points. First point is a crucial point for sisters in general, and I think that's education. Education as part of our gospel mission and as part of Sisters Empowering Women. We know that if you help people to learn something, it's a way of giving them freedom. And I think that's really what is both old and new. I just want to emphasize it in a different way for the newness. When you teach somebody something, you give them new ideas, new words, new concepts, new theories, new ways of thinking. You really help them to be able to do new things in their life. There's a famous philosopher called Wittgenstein who wrote, "The limits of my language are the limits of my world." If you change the language people have, give them new tools, they can do new things. They can think new thoughts and have new actions in their lives. So, this education that we're offering, I think the more we can think about it as something setting people free, we think about our Lord, how often he said that in the Gospels, "I have come that you may live life and live it to the full, to give you freedom, to give you salvation, give you freedom." I think our education, the more we think about it in terms of giving people freedom, giving them tools to do new things, to change the social system around them. And especially when we think about empowering women, that's a real form of empowerment. Second thing I would say is creating institutions that can support women. Often they don't have financial support, they don't have other kinds of backup to help them grow. It depends where we are in the world. Creating special institutions for women in some circumstances isn't really that important, but in other places, it's really important. The sisters on the ground need to be able to judge that and work out what the really important thing is to do. But creating a special place where women can grow is important. We can think that the communities of sisters that we belong to, in some ways, are a special place in which women grow, and we can then share that with others. If we think too about the mission of the church has a mission to the whole world, and yet we still build churches and go there. There's a special place where we experience being church in a specially intense way. So I think this creating institutions to help women really grow, they might be educational, they might be other kinds, cultural, they might be kinds of business structures that are specially focused on women. There could be all kinds of institutions helping them to grow. That's another way in which we can help empower women in line with our gospel mission. The third thing I'd say is a critique, making a critique of the world that we're in. You know, many sisters are in really dramatic situations where human rights are regularly trampled on, and, you know, many other crucial problems are present. In order to make a really good critique now, we need to do more than we did in the past. We need to connect our gospel mission, our gospel knowledge, with proper modern tools that we can get from the social sciences and from other kinds of sciences. We need to be able to collect data. We need to be able to build arguments with those tools. We need to be able to make a good case. And that means we need formation. So that's my third point. Sisters can empower women more if they get more formation, especially in these kinds of sciences that can help promote the whole empowerment of women by giving information, analysis, data that can help direct governments, direct what the church is doing. You know, we can build this critique that can help us work together to confront problems. And then the last thing I would say is we have to be able to tell the story that the sisters are doing. It's partly to do with collecting data, but it's also about publishing reports, telling people what we are doing. You know, in the last couple of years, there's been a very important report that's come out in UK about the work that sisters are doing on human trafficking. It's made an impact on political leaders. It's telling them that this group of people is an important player in building a more human world, in empowering women. So we need to be able to tell those stories. And I hope that the role that I've been given now in the Pontifical Academy of Social Sciences can help us do that, because I hope that one of the things that we will do in the near future is launch a global Catholic World Development Report in which we can start to tell the stories of what Catholics are doing, what the Catholic Church is doing to promote global world development. And the sister story is going to be a really important part of that. So we need data, we need information, we need you to give us information that we can then use in reports like that. And then my last point, we can't finish without saying something about the current crisis that we face in the economy, primarily to do with COVID, but we were already in a crisis to do with the climate change issue. And of course, the whole way in which the modern economy excludes whole ranges of people, the throwaway economy, as Pope Francis talked about it. If I want to say one word to sisters about what we could do to empower women in this circumstance, it's put human dignity at the center of the economy. And I want to say three basic things to sisters about that. If your sisters in rich countries, especially I'm talking to the sisters in the United States, where you have a lot of experience in socially responsible investing, for instance, to ask the question to the big companies, how does human dignity come into your business model? Are you treating your customers as if they are people with human dignity, or are you just taking advantage of them? How do you see human dignity as part of the purpose of your company, and so on? If you are sisters in a barrio, in a really poor area, in a slum, in some of the most excluded parts of the world, one of the things you can do is bring people together and think about how you can build local economy structures around human dignity. We have a lot of resources for doing that now. I'll just give you one. There was an important American woman thinker, Eleanor Ostrom. She won the Nobel Prize for Economics in 2009. And her whole work was looking at how indigenous communities learn to manage their local resources, like say a fishing stock, how they manage together common resources and grow together. So to encourage sisters to learn about this and use this in bringing people together in this real excluded situation to help start building a local little economy to help develop from the low level that they're starting from. And then I'd say to sisters in Western Europe or other places where there's a kind of abandonment of the church, and we often find difficulties, a loss of our role in society. For instance, we often have churches in local areas that are not really frequented very much. The building of the church could be a center for bringing people together from the local community to start to think how we could rebuild that community around the church. The church is a center of solidarity for people who need it right now in this crisis situation. So I want to leave you just with a word of hope and encouragement, because I know very well that the sisters who are listening to me now and all the sisters around the world are very, very competent and capable to deal with the crisis that we're facing. We need to take out of our store things that are old and new and help us to carry forward our gospel-based mission, the words of Christ, the message of Christ, to help to set people free, to help people to develop towards the kingdom of God. Thank you very much.